You're listening to the audio production of Leading Small Groups That Thrive, 5 Shifts to Take Your Small Group to the Next Level, by Ryan T. Hartwig, Courtney W. Davis, and Jason A. Sniff. Published by Zondervan and read by LaQuita James. Foreword read by John Behrens. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperchristianaudio.com.
To Gus and the Guys, for 20-plus years of friendship and discipleship, RTH. To Matt, Luke, and Theo, my favorite and most formative small group, CWD. To Nicole and Team Sniff, Jim Probst, for taking a chance on me, and my amazing team, JAS.
Foreword. Every soul has a story. And they all involve a community, or the lack of one. That's why I've given my life to small group disciple-making. I imagine that's also why you've picked up this book. We know that there's no significant transformation in one person without another. The same goes for the souls leading small groups' ministries. We need each other. As we lead others in transformational communities, we need to be sharpened by a community of fellow leaders with the same mission and passion. I believe you will find such fellow leaders in Courtney, Jason, and Ryan. As soon as you read their stories in the opening, you'll know that you are sitting with small groups champions, not merely gurus. They prove it by doing something rather remarkable for a book like this, though it should probably be how more of these things are written. They invite even more friends along for the community conversation that is leading small groups that thrive. Alongside the author's deft balance of research and real life, you will hear from a diverse community of leaders in the small groups world at the end of each chapter. Each brings nuance and frontline consideration to the material. Some of them are known friends and mentors, and others you will meet for the first time. This is a book about community, written in community. It's a community that helps me, and I've led small groups for almost 20 years now. That's long enough to learn a few things, and long enough to build up some pride against learning new things or relearning some fundamentals. The community that wrote this book reminds me that there are new lessons in old truths about small groups ministry. They've researched the essentials, and they share what they've found here. Sometimes it is surprising. The stats and numbers might upend some long-held assumptions that we have about small groups ministry. What do you mean that 12 isn't the perfect number for a small group? But you'll find the research undeniable. You might find your course being gently corrected. I did. How many times will I have to be reminded that leaders are our lifeblood in small groups ministry? Thank you, Lord, for Courtney, Jason, Ryan, and company for showing me why all over again. They helped remind me that small group disciple-making is not limited by a building, space, or financial issues. Never will be. Groups are only ever limited by lack of leaders, their health, and investment. Leading a small group's ministry is dependent on leading through others. That's classic Ephesians 4 ministry. Groups should be the crown jewel of discovering, developing, and deploying leaders in our local churches. The community of writers here helped me refine some of our own plans for fresh investment in leader development in our group's ministry at the Village Church. And this book lays out an actionable roadmap for leaders to recruit, shape, and build groups that lead others into life transformation. This is the development tool that leaders need. If you can't tell by now, let me tell it plain. I got excited about small groups all over again as I read this book. That's why you should read it and share it. If you're a pastor, use the work here to help your own community of local church leaders get small groups even more. We small groups people tend to be an intuitive bunch, and we don't always grasp why our lead pastor or elders or executive team don't seem to love or understand groups as much as we do. This book is a practical help to you. The community of writers here has given us the gift of fresh metrics and data to cultivate better strategy and operations for small groups ministry in our context. Consider using some of this gold next time you share with your own group leaders or executive pastor. Share it over a series of training sessions with your leaders. I've already started. Groups ministry will always be more art than science. It's messy that way. Courtney, Jason, Ryan, and friends give us a blend of art and science here that will help small group leaders better participate in the mission of God in their living rooms week after week. I'm so grateful for this book and the kindred spirits who authored it. They've helped me in my art, adding increased color and perspective to the craft of cultivating small groups that thrive. Jared Stephen Musgrove, DMIN, Groups Pastor, The Village Church, Co-founder and Executive Director, CommunityLeadership.org.
Introduction. Why we needed this book and why you might also. Ryan's story. It all started in August 1997. I was a sophomore in college. At the student leadership retreat before the start of school, I was eating lunch with five of my buddies when Gus, our campus pastor, came up to our table and uttered the words that would begin a 20-plus year journey of discipleship and friendship. "Hey guys, I see something in you. Can I disciple you this year?" We were flattered. A few of us had just attended his discipleship workshop. Now Gus wanted to disciple us? A few weeks later, we began meeting together, first studying the book of Philippians in his office, and then interspersing many rounds of frisbee golf with serious conversation and Bible study. The following year, we met weekly, and Gus got each of us involved in bringing the word, so he could not only give each of us the opportunity to teach, but coach us as we did. The following year, Gus made it clear that he expected each of us to find a group of guys we could invest in and disciple too. We did, but we kept meeting together as well, becoming the best of friends along the way. When graduation arrived, we committed to getting together once a year for the rest of our lives. Last May, we'd celebrated 23 years together. We've laughed, cried, and yelled together. We've lived lots of life together. We've seen God do incredible things. God has spoken to me through these friends, and through me, He has spoken to them. I've shared some of the greatest experiences of my life with these guys. Perhaps our most poignant moment together happened during our annual trip a few years ago. Late one night, God wooed back to Himself one of my friends who had wandered away from the faith. And He used us in that process as we prayed for and with our friend, battled the enemy's lies together, and cheered as Jesus revealed Himself to my friend just as the sun came up the next morning. This was our 21st century version of the story of the paralytic's friends digging through the roof and lowering their sick friend to Jesus, which is recounted in Mark 2. It was amazing. But it hasn't always been that way. Together we fought, wrestled, and almost given up more than a few times. But God has used this group of men to help each of us look a little bit more like Jesus as the years have passed. When we first got together, Gus made it clear that this group wasn't just for us. It was something for us to share with others. Since then, I've led multiple groups of college students and young men trying to make their way in the world. My wife and I have also led groups of families seeking community and growth, as well as young married couples desiring to serve God in their marriages, careers, and families. We've made great friends. We've seen God move in amazing ways, and we are all better for those experiences. I believe in groups with everything in me, but if I'm honest, the groups I've led along the way have struggled for some of the same reasons your groups likely have. Lack of commitment, fear of breaking up for the sake of the gospel, confused purpose, dominating, or nearly non-existent members. I've never felt like I had all the answers to the challenges that have arisen, but I want those answers for myself and for you, so that all of us can lead groups that thrive. That's why I've engaged this project and why I'm writing this book. Jason's story. Over 40 years ago, my mom and dad were living in Rockford, Illinois. They were invited to join a group of people who met in a home to spend time together and study the Bible. My parents wanted relationships with other Christians, but they were reluctant to commit since they had never been part of a small group before. They said yes anyway. What ensued was a group of couples and families who committed to living in community and who challenged each other to grow in Jesus. Through group and individual discipleship, my parents experienced the power of like-minded friends who truly cared for each other. My parents came from family backgrounds riddled with divorce and addiction. And in their small group, they encountered new models for their marriage and family. When I was a year old, my parents, through the loving support and guidance of their small group, decided to give their lives to Jesus and to raise my brother and me to love Jesus and serve Him. Their time in that small group changed the trajectory of their lives and provided new purpose and direction. Years later, when my wife and I moved to Normal, Illinois, we faced a similar situation. We needed a new church family and a group of people we could call our own. We struggled for a while to find a church and community that seemed right. Several months later, a friend invited my wife to Thanksgiving dinner with her small group. 3 years later, I was hired to help our church's small group's ministry grow. I still chuckle every time I think about my parents' journey and how it reveals God's sense of humor and providence. Small groups continue to deeply impact my family journey. My family, Teen Sniff, now includes 6 kids, a small group in and of itself, and I have been on staff for over 9 years as a small group's pastor, charged with helping others connect into groups and helping leaders and groups be the best they can be. One seemingly innocuous invitation to visit a gathering of people 40-some years ago has transformed my entire family's journey. If done well, I think such groups can transform you and yours. Courtney's story. I was invited by sorority sisters. Every week, 8 to 10 girls gathered in the USC Theta House for a Bible study. They were friends of mine, but I wasn't yet a Christian. It was because of this group of smart, ambitious, kind, fun young women that I started to understand who Jesus was and what community was for. I graduated from the University of Southern California 1.5 years later, found a church, and plugged in. Unfortunately, the small group of young professional women I joined at that church had the makings of a reality TV show: drama, gossip, doubts about God and the church, and a lack of direction. At one point, the church leaders had to intervene to make an attempt at reconciliation. It didn't work. Nope. No more church small groups for me. I was on a skiing and snowboarding trip with a sorority sister when I met Lisa. We got to know one another well on the road and on our snowboards. When we came down from the mountain, the three of us committed to lean into our desire for community and hospitality, starting what would become our Sunday supper club. We'd meet for dinner and play games with young professional Christians. Sometimes it was just fun. Other times we went deep. It was the first time I experienced Christian community as an adult. Years later, my husband Matt and I were both volunteering as leaders in the high school ministry at our church in Santa Barbara. We hosted small groups of high school students and the college-age high school leaders. We may not have been perfectly fit to lead, but we were willing. I participated in Beth Moore Bible studies. Matt attended men's prayer breakfasts. And after we had our first kiddo, we participated in home groups with the parents of our former high schoolers. To be in relationship with those parents was such a joy for all of us. They weren't old enough to be our parents, and we weren't young enough to be their kids. They spoke such encouragement to us and prayed bold prayers with and for us during a season of great change. Now, Matt and I co-lead a church growth group of young professionals in their mid to late 20s, equipping them with the Word of God to send them back out into their workplaces and relationships more sure of God's purposeful placement and plan. Again, we aren't always convinced we're fit to lead, but we are still willing. While I was ready to write off groups forever after that first church small group disaster 15 years later, I'm convinced that the Lord can do incredible things through regular, intimate gatherings of broken, hopeful people. But I've wondered for years how to participate with God in facilitating the incredible things that can happen through groups. In my more prideful moments, I knew exactly what to do and how to do it. But in my more humble moments, I realized I still have a lot of questions. A different kind of small groups book. Our lives have been deeply impacted by small groups in so many different ways. The three of us want more people to be as deeply influenced in and through groups as we have been. But we've also been in your shoes, leading groups week in and week out. We've encountered difficult conversations, waning attendance and commitment, and a lack of resources to help us address our group's issues. So when we, two social scientists and a small group's pastor, started talking, we decided to ask good questions that would result in better answers to the most vexing challenges group leaders face. The perspective we've taken is unique from any other book on small groups. We've integrated church-based research on small groups, hearing from over 800 small group members, not just leaders, in-depth academic knowledge of small group and team communication, practical examples based on visits we made to numerous small groups, and our own experiences leading small groups and small groups programs over decades. Leading Small Groups That Thrive provides a research-driven yet practical resource that group leaders can use immediately. Our research on members, leaders, and pastors. The truth is that many small groups in churches, colleges, universities, and communities like yours are thriving. So we found those groups and studied them. Our major research project ran from 2017 to 2019, during which we worked with smallgroups.com, who helped us collect survey data from small groups pastors, small group leaders, and small group members. This yielded data from almost 100 pastors, over 150 small group leaders, and over 800 small group members, representing over 100 of the healthiest small groups from those churches, which included both mainline and evangelical churches. In addition, we visited many small groups and watched them in action. We conducted dozens of interviews with group members, leaders, and small groups pastors to learn what is working, what is not, and what resources they need to be fully equipped for the long haul. Most studies on small groups take their cues from just leaders or just pastors. Very few actually include the voices of group members. Small group members told us about their leaders, their church's small group priorities, and their personal engagement and spiritual growth. By listening to group members talk about their groups and what makes them great, we've gleaned insights to help you make great choices about how to lead your group and maximize your group's impact. Hearing directly from group members enabled us to learn how groups actually contribute to their members' spiritual growth. While groups composed of spiritually mature Christians may look like effective groups, their effectiveness may be attributed primarily to the spiritual maturity of individuals rather than the groups themselves. We were most interested in identifying group practices that contribute to growth in individual members' spiritual health. You might be asking how we measured spiritual health. Good question. There are probably as many ways to slice and dice spiritual maturity as there are churches. But we didn't want to create a new scorecard. So we adapted the five areas of spiritual health that Steve Gladden proposed in his book, Small Groups with Purpose, and uses in his own ministry at Saddleback Church. The five areas include worship, fellowship, discipleship, ministry, and evangelism. We use Gladden's established elements of spiritual health to investigate how much each member's small group contributed to these specific areas of his or her individual spiritual health. and to learn the factors that most influence growth through groups.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.